Welcome to the new school. And thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight. I love seeing familiar faces, and I love seeing new faces even more. So welcome to all you first-timers. I hope you do talk to the people sitting around you, make some friends, make some connections. That's also what this is really all about. So it's great to see such an amazing turnout to learn about making your grammar classes more effective, more engaging, and more instructive with the wonderful Irene Schoenberg. We are thrilled to have Irene back here. She was here 3 years ago, and since that time, she's become a little bit of a legend here at the new school. Yes, it's true. Did you know that? Yes. In senior meetings with deans, with very high-level people, we talk about the Irene Schoenberg video, which is on the new school YouTube channel. So I don't know if you're aware, but New School has kind of a reputation for these very high-profile public events. We get very famous politicians, actors, leading thinkers in the field, and we have a very robust YouTube channel of very, very famous people. Well, Irene Schoenberg's video, her presentation on teaching grammar to multi-level classes, is the number two viewed video of all time in the New School YouTube channel. All time. Pretty awesome. I think that's fabulous. She outpaced Noam Chomsky and Victoria Beckham. Big deal. So there were 292,611 views. That is awesome. That is awesome. So what does that mean? What does that mean? First of all, Irene's a wonderful presenter, and we love her, but it also means that ESL teachers are incredibly passionate and engaged professionals who are always looking to learn and who are always looking to learn a new idea and a new activity to teach grammar. We can never get enough grammar activities, right? And that's why you're all here tonight, yes. So I'm sure tonight we will also get some great, great new ideas. I want to say a special thank you to Pearson English and their team. We love working with Rob Renner. He always does a great job. So please take some time, look at their wonderful books. Also, please mark your calendar now, April 6th, we are doing another event with Pearson. This is the first ever intercollegiate spelling bee. It's going to be on a big stage, and it's going to be the best spellers from the New School IEP program going up against PACE's best spellers from their IEP program. It's going to be fantastic. You can bring your classes, very inspiring. Bring your colleagues for ideas. Think about doing it in your own schools. So we hope to see you there. There's a flyer with some details about that. Also, Rob wanted me to mention that if you registered, we have your email. If you've come in and you didn't RSVP before, please leave him your email, and he will be sending everybody something free and great.
He'll be sending an electronic professional development certificate for everybody that participated.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Rob. All right, now it is my great pleasure to introduce our featured speaker, Irene Schoenberg.
Thank you so much, Caitlin. I'm thrilled to be back here. I love these sessions. I love to listen. I love to be here. And I'm thrilled that I'm able to speak to you today because I've attended sessions and at times, I've disagreed with the speakers, and now I have a chance to tell you why. Anyway, today I'm going to talk about making our classes more fun, more instructive. But before I get into it, I'd like you to think about a grammar class. You're observing a grammar class. Write down one thing that you'd really want to see in it, and one thing that would be the worst thing you could see in a grammar class. So just take a second and write it down, okay? Right now. What would you want to see, and what would be the worst thing you could see? as we all know, the pendulum swings. At times, we put more of an emphasis on grammar, and at times, we just speak about function and communication. And there are different schools. There's Diane Larson Freeman, who said grammar is the backbone of the language. And people like Stephen Krasher, who say grammar may not help, it may even hurt, with the idea that grammar will somehow take care of itself. Okay, in 2017, in fact, grammar is in. We're all aware of it, but why? Why do you think, at this particular time, we're kind of proud to teach grammar? We use grammar terminology, we teach grammar. Why? What are the other ideas of these times that have made grammar something we feel is important in our classes? Yes, one of it is accountability. Any other?
Structure.
Structure? Did you say
lack
what?
Lack of structure and needing structure.
Okay, needing structure in what?
In communication.
In writing? Okay, any other reasons? Yes.
The newspapers always say kids can't write a sentence, and they're right.
Okay. Okay, I think you're absolutely right, and I think, in fact, there are four reasons today. We place an emphasis on academic writing. Many of our students want to go to college, and they know if they attend a school, they're going to have to write papers. At the same time, there is research from corpus linguistics, which has been pointing out to us the big difference in different types of writing. If it's texting, email, informal writing, academic papers, newspapers, fiction, or conversation. We now are getting more and more aware of what the different structures are, and that's a focus on form. So once again, grammar's back in. The other reason I think is today, all over the schools, we have standards and objectives in our books, in our curriculum. We want students to be able to say, by the end of this unit, I'll be able to do such and such. And in the standards, almost always have some grammar focus. So again, grammar's in. And finally, computers. Computers allow students to work at their own pace and learn forms. And so, in 2017, I think we're all comfortable with grammar. Grammar's back in. L.G. Kelly wrote a book in the 1970s called 25 Centuries of Language Teaching, in which he said something that I think is absolutely true. There's always been a cyclical evolution of ideas about language learning. We discard ideas only to bring them back with modification. Today, I'd like to talk about these modifications in the field of grammar. First, I'm going to talk about our priorities in teaching grammar today. Second, I'd like to talk about the role of corpus linguistics in our classes. And finally, a few conclusions. We all know that priorities are important in life as well as in grammar. And this is a particularly good time to talk about priorities. You know why? The Super Bowl games this weekend. Do you know the story of the Super Bowl game? Okay. A man went to the Super Bowl game, and the seat next to him was empty. He was really surprised to find an empty seat. And he said to the woman on the other side of the empty seat, "I'm surprised. Scalpers are getting thousands of dollars for tickets. How come there's an empty seat?" And the woman said, "The seat belonged to my late husband." The man said, "Oh, I'm so terribly sorry to hear that." The woman said, "Thank you." But the man persisted after a minute, and he said, "But I'm still surprised that none of his friends or relatives wanted the ticket." And the woman said, "I was surprised too. They all wanted to attend the funeral. Priorities, right? When it comes to teaching grammar, we try to follow the following four steps. First, grammar in context. Second, a clear, concise grammar explanation. Third, practice, lots of guided practice. And finally, the very most important part of any grammar class, getting the students to use the structure in some open-ended, creative way, not just in speaking, but also in writing. Why do we need a four-step approach? Well, this was my class last semester. We have someone like Esther in the front row, who's been in the country for 4 years, and she understands almost everything, but she has absolutely no control of grammar. She has no idea of grammar. She just gets her idea across. She communicates, but with no structure. We also have Ara, who's pointing her finger, who's studied grammar for quite a few years in Korea, and she does know the form, she even knows the meaning, but what she needs is lots of practice, lots of communication practice using the structures. And then we have, there's a sister and brother, they're from Venezuela, and they need a little bit of everything. They're excellent students, they really want to get ahead, but they need an introduction, they need to learn the rules, they need to practice, and they need open-ended communication. And so clearly we need a four-step approach to cover the students in our class. Why teach grammar in context? Well, we say, is it more interesting as opposed to a discrete sentence? Yeah. Any other reasons?
They'll remember it.
They'll remember it better. Any other reasons?
It motivates students more because they're applying it to something that's real.
Absolutely. It motivates them because they're applying it to something real. It's not an isolated sentence, right? And I think clearly people will feel that they get more bang for their buck, right? Even if they don't learn the structure, they may learn lots of things incidentally, right? Okay, now let's change hats. Is there a problem with grammar in context? Well, there can be. If, in fact, you give a beautiful piece of art or a very, very good story, but the grammar seems incidental. So what's the solution? And I think the real solution is finding a context that really, really relates to the grammar. And I think this is a very, you know, I'm going to show you a few examples. You're teaching the present progressive. A wonderful example is people watching. Look around here. Is anybody smiling? Is anybody looking at a phone? Look, 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 look. Is anybody yawning? Texting? Okay. It's very easy to get students to people watch and get them to practice the grammar at the same time. Another example is reporting events, the past progressive and the simple past. What were you doing when the storm began? What were you doing when you heard the election results? What did you do when you heard the election results? We always have to try to think how we can use the grammar and get our students involved in it in some way that they'll react to. How about changes? How has your city changed? How have you changed? I used to have dark hair, now I don't. Or travel trips. When I go to a foreign country, I never know how much to tip. I never know how much to tip here. So you see, if you could get the students to remember the content and the grammar at the same time, and if you repeat it and give them these sentences, they'll see how the context makes sense. Because we all will say, if I asked anybody in the field, do you teach grammar and context? Yes. And everybody will say, grammar and context is wonderful. But that's not enough. To really make it work, you must make sure the context you choose has a real connection with the grammar. And then it'll be, I think, somewhat more effective. The next question is, what do you do with the grammar in context? And I have a few suggestions that I think will work. First of all, this is very easy to do. I always like to have tips that are easy. You take the page, white out the grammar. You could white out some of the vocabulary also. And this is after the students have read it and heard it, and they play it again. They kind of have an idea, but they're forced to listen very carefully. And they like it, and you don't have to do any work, because since they have the book, you can then let them open the book and check their own work. And I just tried it the other day with my class. Miriam, you're observing my class. I gave them one of the grammar in contexts. I whited it out. They filled in the simple past tense, affirmative, negative, and it was a feeling of satisfaction for them because they were really going over something they knew and doing it again. It's also quite easy for you. Read it, listen to it. They can even do the exercises that follow it, but then bring it back, having them listen to it and just fill in the answers. It's not very difficult. Another good idea, because I think what we're trying to do now, and this is the modification, it's a small modification, but we're trying to tie in our context with the grammar focus so that it's a stronger connection. Give them some comprehension questions that use the actual grammar. Let's say you're teaching present progressive, give them questions, affirmative, negative, about the reading. The person in the reading is or isn't sitting at the airport. I don't know if the person is or isn't, but they see the grammar and they will be circling the correct answer based on what they heard and seeing the grammar. Another good activity is one in which you get the students to interact with the reading. Ask them some question where they look at the reading and they have an answer that uses the grammar. And finally, I always like to end a grammar in context by having students close the book and simply ask them, what do you remember? Why do that? Why is that a good idea? Close the book, what do you remember? What happens then? What? It's like a quick test for themselves. And there have been studies that show that you can improve your memory by working at it. So if you give them a what do you remember each time you have a grammar in context, they'll get better at it. Okay. Now, as I told you, there are some people who don't believe that grammar is so necessary, that grammar helps. But I've always believed grammar is important. And I'll tell you my own story. I bet you have your own. My parents came to the United States from Vienna about 8 years before I was born. And they spoke German at home. But they wanted me to speak English, and they only spoke English to me. However, I understood German because that's what they spoke to each other and to their friends and their relatives. When I got to high school, though, I began to study French as a foreign language. And I loved the idea of studying French, and I studied it, and I was pretty good. But the classes met once or twice a week, and the books were very, very traditional. They were discrete sentences. There were lots of conjugation. But I liked learning French. And when I was 16, I went to Europe for the first time. And when we got to France, to Paris, I said to my parents, I'll do all the talking. I proceeded to use my terrible French, and people spoke back to me in English, or maybe they spoke back to me in French, and I probably didn't understand them, but had a very good time of it. A week later, we went to Vienna, and when we got to Vienna, people spoke to me in German. Of course, I understood what they were saying, but I became very inhibited. I didn't want to speak German because I thought I would sound stupid. I didn't know if I should use der, die, das, dem. I didn't know anything about the form, the structure, and so I didn't use German. I had one sentence, ich verstehe, ich kann nicht sprechen, something like that, where I just didn't speak to them. And it was from that time, even before I read the studies that show the importance of a focus on form, that I always knew that adult learners want to know something about the language. It gives them confidence. So, how do we teach the grammar? What do you do with the charts and the notes? What are your best approaches to helping students understand the form and the meaning? How do you explain the charts? How do you teach the notes?
They usually do so implicitly.
Okay, very good. Basically, there are two ways we like to teach them. One is we give the students examples, and we have them give us the rule. And the other is we give them the rule and have them give us many different examples. Any other ways to teach the grammar?
Compare and contrast.
Compare
and contrast.
Very good. Compare and contrast two different grammar points. You know, immediately, what's the difference between
the present perfect and the present perfect progressive?
Exactly.
When can
they
be used interchangeably, when not?
Exactly.
To be going to and will. When can we use them in English interchangeably with very little or no difference meaning?
Very good. So you heard a very good way is to show a contrast, particularly a contrast in meaning. I've read a book. I've been reading a book. In one case, you still may be reading it, right? Okay. When it comes to the notes, I think it's very important for us as teachers to decide which notes, in fact, are really important for the particular group we have and which are not that important. And in the latest edition of Focus on Grammar, we've redesigned the notes in a way that teachers and students can see what the note is about with a little heading on top. And I think that's going to be very beneficial because I know that in some cases you have, like this is very beginning, it's the verb be. And for true beginners, I would probably only give the first three notes where they see three forms, negative, and contractions. But for a more advanced group, you might go into all five notes. I also think it's important to point out things to be careful, mistakes. And we've tried to show this in red highlights. Be careful, you don't want to repeat the subject, Marco, he is a student. We also want to point out differences between writing and speaking. So these are things we can do with the notes. One thing I discovered, and this was something a friend, a colleague was doing, is she would write. This is to show the form. She would write the words on index cards and let pairs of students put them in sentences. What are some of the grammar points that confuse students because of the word order?
Embedded
questions. I wonder where he lives. What is another grammar form that's confusing? Adjective order. It's a book pretty. It's a girl pretty, right? Any others?
The use of the past tense, did you went there? Does Samantha like it? So
okay.
Beginners not knowing that once one form is marked, English is a language of economy with verbs, no need to mark the other.
Okay. Well, what I ended up doing is I would give my students two sentences, and I would have them work together and put them in the correct word order. It's the only thing you have to do is make sure that if you have different groups, that you keep the envelope straight. But it's very easy. You can do it again and again. And they really get involved manipulating the words, and it stays with them. So it's a nice way to help students when you know they're going to make a mistake with the form and the with the word order. I think that these index cards are very good, but I think my students were more excited about them than they might have been because of the Hawthorne effect. Has anybody heard of the Hawthorne effect? Okay, this is something they often teach business students because it was an experiment that was done in a factory, I think it was 1920s or 1930s. They had a control group and they had the experimental group. And they spoke to the experimental group and they said, look at the wall color, the color of the wall. Do you think we should change it? And the workers said yes. So they painted the wall yellow. Okay. And you know what happened? Production went up. Okay. 6 months later, they got those same people together and they said, look at the lighting. It's not very good. The workers said yes. So they put in some brighter bulbs. And you know what happened? Production went up. 6 months later, they brought the people together and they said, these yellow walls, they're much too bright. Let's paint them white again. And you know what happened? Production went up. And what they found was when people are involved and you make a change, people become more excited, more enthusiastic. And I think that's something that we should always think about when we're teaching. How can I tweak what I'm doing? How can I do it a little differently? And I bet you'll see your students will be markedly awake. If you're, you know, if you suddenly bring in these little index cards, your students will really like it. But after a while, you have to do something else, a different game. The third step that we all do in a grammar class is focused practice. And I think that today, students can get more than enough practice because if they do a book, if they do a workbook, they can also do lots and lots of exercises online. But how do you do the exercises? How do you get them involved in them? Get the students to write on the board, and I agree. I also get my students to come up and do as much writing as possible. What else do you do with the exercises?
Students do mini presentations, or they make their videos on their smartphones and present the videos to the class.
That must be really wonderful. That's probably more in the communication practice, though, that goes to the next step, right?
Right, but they have to use the grammar that they learned in the previous class in the presentation.
Okay, I think that's what we all want them to ultimately do. I'm sure that works brilliantly. But getting back to focused practice, do you have them go over the answers with a partner? I think that works. How about just giving them a quiz based on having done the exercises? Do you ever bring in a blank of an exercise and let them fill it out at the beginning of class? I do that. I don't have the time, the luxury of going over every exercise with them in class. And yet, I want them to do every exercise. So sometimes I go over some of the exercises and I give them the answers to the others so they can check their own work. And then when they come in, I say, okay, fill it in first thing. It gets them to work hard so that I can get to the last stage, which is the open-ended communication work, as you heard before. Another thing about the exercises, it's nice to start with the Discover the Grammar, where they, in some way, point out that they understand the form and the meaning, and end with the editing exercises. Do you do the editing exercises with your students?
So correct the mistakes.
Right. Now, why are those exercises so good?
Because Well, some of the answers are right, obviously, so they have to actually figure out. They're not all wrong, so they have to say, okay, what's right, what's wrong, so that makes them think.
You know that a long time ago, we weren't allowed to have editing exercises in our books. Do you know why? Anybody want to guess why they weren't allowed?
You don't want to teach errors.
Exactly. They said students are going to learn from their errors. In fact, we found that the editing exercises are the ones that help them improve their own writing. Because but if you keep on giving them these editing exercises, eventually they can pick out the errors and pick them out in their own work. So I think they're very good exercises. Okay, the last step in a grammar class, and the most important one, is communication practice. Usually we start with a listening, and again, the listening will use the grammar and get the students to kind of react to it in some way. In this case, they're going to look at people and describe them using present progressive. And the first exercise, they listen and they have to identify the people. You know, we're talking about two people, Joe and Sue. Joe is wearing whatever, and Sue is wearing, and they have to, from the picture, find the people. Okay, there's another exercise here, who's wearing what? And I assure you, if you have a reasonably small class and a reasonably large room, it works very well. You have the students sit back to back, and they introduce themselves to one another, and they have to tell the person that they don't see what the person is wearing. It does work well. But maybe you have a larger group like we have here. What could you do? Well, let me suggest to you, introduce yourself to somebody near you, somebody that you don't know. Right now, introduce yourself to somebody. Now close your eyes, and tell that person what that person is wearing. What I'm trying to say is, every book will give you a suggested activity, but classes are different, and not every book activity will work in your particular class. And what we as teachers have to do is figure out how we can make it work for the particular group of students that we have. That's really part of the art of being a teacher. There are a couple of other exercises. Exercise 8 has students take pictures with their phone of a group of students and then have the group of students exchange clothes or have a different pose, and then they look at their pictures and compare them. And then the last one, which is a common present progressive exercise, compare the two pictures. What are 10 differences? And I think that you'll find the exercise works well, but it'll be much better if you get the students to take charge of the activity and let them choose a picture of their own and doctor it up. I mean, I just chose the most famous, but students will pick out their own pictures, and many of our students are very, very talented, and they'll come up with a lot of differences, and then you can do two things. You can either have them describe the differences in their picture, or have them give it to somebody else who describes the differences in their picture. Now, I think that students will enjoy the activity, but we have to remember that we want them to feel they're actually learning something, and we're looking at them, and we're trying to help them. So what I like to do is give them a little speaking rubric, because I want them to understand that grammar is very, very important, but it's only a small part of what they have to do. So to the extent that they get a rubric like this and you listen to them it'll be very obvious, because I've tried it with my own students. Some of the students will use the grammar correctly, but they'll lack all fluency. They'll slow. There'll be too much time, too many pauses, too many hesitations. Some of them will not say very much. There won't be any content. They may be correct. They may even be fluent. Some of them may be fine in grammar and vocabulary, but their pronunciation will be off. If you can point out to them their weakness and their strength, I think they'll feel, wow, I did an activity, I used the grammar, and I also got help with my language ability. And it'll be different for different students. Okay, an activity like that, I will probably divide the class in half. One day half speak, one day the other speak. I limit them in time because I don't want a whole class of speeches, but I give them 1 minute to talk about their pictures. And while they're talking, I will mark the rubric. And it's not a lot of work for you, and it really is helpful for them. Absolutely. I give them the rubric. I explain the rubric. I explain what fluency is, the flow, the ease. I give them a demonstration. Pronunciation, they understand. Content, I talk a little bit about. It's not enough to have three perfect sentences. You have to say something more meaningful. And then, as students speak, I'll always point out the good thing. Wow. Your pronunciation was great. Sometimes we have students who are terrible, but they have excellent pronunciation. They'll feel good, and they'll, you know, it's an eye-opener for others. This counts too. Okay, the final section of every grammar class should be from grammar to writing. And what we've tried to do in the latest edition is ease students into process writing. We give them a topic, and we have them use the grammar of the unit in the topic. Now, on the lower levels, we actually give them a model. On the higher levels, we don't give them a model because they're expected to come up with their own ideas, but we lead them. We give them graphic organizers. We get them involved. And also, on the three higher levels, we tell them what errors they should try and avoid. Another thing we've done is we have them use the grammar and underline the grammar in their composition. I mean, it sounds like nothing, but if they underline it, they're more apt to use it correctly. We also give them some editing checklists so that they go back again, reread what they've written, and look that they didn't make certain mistakes. And then we have them revise one more time if they can. So we try to help them take charge of their writing, incorporate the target grammar, and do it for every unit. Now, it's nice for us, because if you're a writing teacher, we all know how hard it is to read those compositions, those long compositions. But if you're the grammar teacher, and you give them a paragraph, and that paragraph is based on the grammar they've just studied so many ways, they're apt to make fewer mistakes, it's more controlled, and it really, I mean, I found it really does work well. So I encourage you to give them these from grammar to writing at the end of every unit. It also points out to them it's not just doing well on discrete sentences. That's not enough. That's not knowing the grammar. It's knowing it in a paragraph or even two paragraphs. Okay. I'd now like to turn around and talk about something entirely different. And this is corpus linguistics. Okay, corpus linguistics, in fact, is very, very exciting, mostly because it's telling us about frequency, which words are used most often, which collocations go together, which words are put together. But most of all, it tells us about register, which words are used in academic writing, which words are used in informal conversation, which words are used in newspaper articles, etc. I believe that research from corpus linguistics is truly going to give us new and exciting and revolutionary ideas about teaching. But I don't think that's the case today, and I don't believe that's the case with the grammar. Now, at a previous New School session, somebody stood up and said, it's revolutionary, and all the old grammar books are not really using corpus information. Well, to me, that meant I better study corpus linguistics, I better find out everything, and see what's behind it. And so, I, Marjorie Fuchs, the author of Fog 3 and 4, Jay Maurer and Margot Bonner, studied corpus linguistics and became corpus informed. And what I'd like to do this evening is tell you some of the results and how they fit into our grammar teaching. This came from actually an article, also a speech, which said that traditional grammar texts reflect the, quote, intuition, anecdotal evidence, and traditions about what should or shouldn't appear in a grammar book. Corpus-based materials are authentic and research-based. Therefore, writers using corpus-based research know better what should or shouldn't appear in a grammar book. Now, corpus-based research is just one tiny part of the decisions about what should or shouldn't appear in a book. And the real decision is the way you use the corpus findings, the way you use the research. And I believe that's always based on the experience of teachers. I think that today, more than ever before, the experience of teachers is not appreciated. Almost everything else is. And I think we should be proud of our experience and prove to others that we do know what's best for our students. I think that's very important. What is corpus linguistics? Corpus linguistics is a field of linguistics which studies large samples of naturally occurring language stored in computer databases in order to understand better how the language is used. Corpus-based means that every example came from a corpus. Corpora is computer-based. Now, corpus linguistics actually preceded computers, but it was very difficult to get large, large numbers. It's now that we have computers that the numbers can be billions. Corpus-informed means that a person, materials writer, or teacher has taken into account research from corpus linguistics. Okay, and now I have five examples. How do you teach this and that? How do you teach it, generally?
Well, no, this book, mm-hmm. That door.
Okay.
Right in the classroom, you can start.
Absolutely, exactly. So we usually teach this for something that's close, and that's for something that's far away. But a very interesting bit of research shows that we use that in conversation. How? Anybody know? How do we use that? Okay, that's for a higher level. But for the beginners, a way that's really common that you'll all agree is we do use it when we're referring back to something like, hey, that's interesting. That's right. Yeah? Okay. So this is something I wasn't aware of, or I didn't think of, and the corpus did inform me, and it was very good. So what do we do now? Not a big deal. I just added it to grammar notes and practice it so that students now know, and I think we should all let them know, this is near, that's far, but that's is also used to refer back. That's right. Okay. What are the two most common present perfect forms used in conversation, or which verbs are used most commonly? Have been and have said, okay? Those were the findings. So, being corpus informed, Marjorie included examples in Fog 3, not telling students because it didn't seem necessary, but showing it in examples and in exercises. Another bit of corpus information is tend to is used frequently in academic language. And so this was added to the verb plus infinitive in FOG 3. It was added so that students can practice it. The three examples I gave you are interesting, but they're not going to make a huge bit of difference in the greater scheme of things. The next one I found more interesting. Simple present used much more frequently than present progressive. Maybe we all knew this. I don't know, but it happens to be true, and it's not just a little more frequent, it's much more frequent. But a corpus linguist criticized traditional grammar books for teaching the present progressive before the simple present. And I laughed. Okay. Why would people want to teach present progressive first? Any ideas?
Well, you start with be and then it's just following be.
Exactly. The notion was that we start with the verb be, and it's easier for students to learn there's a verb plus ing than third person singular, do and does, etc. Okay. So I thought, well, that's a good idea. On the other hand, the simple present is very common, and people who don't know much English tend to know sentences such as, I live in Queens, I have a sister, I work at a restaurant. I happened to start with the simple present in FOG, but I think in some other textbook, I started with the present progressive. I don't think that makes a big difference. But there is something that I learned from being corpus informed, which is different from another person. My experience as a teacher told me that I should give my students much more practice with the simple present than with the present progressive. And that was my result of being corpus informed. So I think it makes more sense to do it that way, but I don't know. But I don't think it matters whether you begin with the simple present or present progressive, but I do think it's helpful to give more practice with the simple present because it is so much more common. Finally, the last example from corpus linguistics is research shows that apostrophe S not and apostrophe R E not are more common after pronouns than isn't and aren't. So we tend to say, he's not a student, but Pedro isn't a student. Okay, this is information from corpus. And this was information that I've seen in beginning grammar books. When I saw it, I thought, this is nuts. Absolutely nuts. Why? Am I nuts? Am I wrong? I thought, it's ridiculous. I am so happy if my beginning students use either form, since they're both correct, that I feel it's burdening them with too much information by telling them this. And that's why I feel very, very strongly that we all should be corpus informed, and then we have to make decisions about how we're going to use that information. So that was my response to people who said otherwise. Before I go into my conclusions, I asked you at the beginning to write down what you would think is the worst thing you could possibly see in a grammar class, and I'd like to hear what some of you wrote down.
Memorizing rules. I think it's the worst thing.
If you saw students stand up with memorized rules without any application, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Any other things that you would see as the worst thing?
Open-ended lecture.
In other words, the teacher is simply lecturing.
Yeah,
completely teacher-centered. No interaction. Any other ideas about what's the worst thing you would see in observing a class?
Teacher doesn't know grammar.
Did you hear that? Say it again.
The teacher doesn't know grammar.
Oh,
the teacher makes a mistake using in teaching grammar. What else? Anything else? Students are sleeping in the class. They're bored. Bored out of their mind. Anything else? The teacher talks too much.
Going from focus practice and then going into more of a open practice, and the students just not having gotten the grammar point.
Going to open-ended practice, realizing the students hadn't a clue to what the grammar point was. They missed the point. Any other things that would be the worst thing you could see?
Teacher sleeping.
Teacher sleeping in class? Okay, totally mechanical class.
Not making corrections.
Okay, not making corrections, allowing students to make mistakes that are not corrected with the particular point that you're teaching.
They are still using English to their foreign original language dictionaries.
The students are translating from
translating
from their language, not transferring it to English. Any other things that you would consider the worst? I asked you because I had asked a couple of directors what they thought would be the worst thing they could see, and I got very different answers. One actually said exactly what somebody here said, that the worst thing she could see would be a teacher making a mistake. Because honestly, what do we have to do? We have to know the grammar. And it's really, it's not just a matter of kind of knowing the rule. We have to know it so well that we can hear it and correct it and know how to scaffold with it. Another thing that we really have to know when we're teaching grammar is different methods. Today we say we live in a post-method era. We use eclectic approaches, but to the extent that we have a lot of different methods under our belt and we can use them, our teaching will be more effective. We'll know, we're teaching the imperative, let's do some total physical response. Or we can adapt the different methods to the different grammar points. A totally different part of teaching is knowing our students, being aware of what they know, what they can do. Is the quiet student quiet because they're shy, or are they quiet because they don't know anything? Is the student who seems so sleepy in class, as I had this semester, sleepy because he's just staying up playing games, or is it because he's actually working in his uncle's store 70 hours a week and is absolutely exhausted? We have to know who our students are to really meet their needs. We also have to know how to pace and scaffold appropriately. If the students don't get it, that means we haven't done enough scaffolding. We haven't brought it down to their level. On the other hand, if the students have learned this grammar in their country because they've studied grammar for 10 years, we don't have to go over the form and the rules. We have to give them much more of that open-ended material. And finally, if at all possible, we should try and make it fun. I want to thank you so much. You've been a wonderful audience, and it's been a pleasure talking to you. If anybody has any questions.
I love your books, by the way, and I'm using level 5 now and the textbook and the workbook. I've noticed a marked difference. But for the lower levels, regarding diagramming sentences, do you incorporate, like you have some of the cards, for the lower levels, do you incorporate any sentence diagramming? Or is that a good thing? What's your
If it works, it's good. I don't do diagramming, but I certainly will do all sorts of things that help the students.
I'm curious, in the
articles that you have chosen, and I'm using Grammar 5 also, but have you envisioned them for more for high school or for adult learners? I'd say adult learners, but they have been used in high school.
Actually, going back to the make it fun thing and also tying back into the Hawthorne effect, so I found that that kind of breaks down along cultural lines, that the idea of playing games and even the idea of, like, you know, I've tried to let my students choose the textbook, I bring options, and I find that in general, students from a Soviet background or an Arab background, do, especially if they're above, older than 30, they don't like that. They don't want games and they don't want agency.
You know, I have had exactly the same experience where I remember in particular thinking, oh, I should make it more fun. And a student told me, I don't want games, I want to learn. And I think this is part of what we have to do as teachers. We have to be sensitive to who are the students, what works well with them, and they'll give you clues. I mean, some students, they love the idea of playing a game, and some students, their faces will show, it's a waste of time. I want to have a serious discussion. We have to alter it. I would not play games if I had a group that...
What about in a mixed group?
Again, sometimes I would not use games very often in a mixed group. I would in a group that, you know, enjoyed them, but you don't have to. That's an extra. The students are most happiest when they learn and when they show what they've learned. The bottom line is students who learn a lot are satisfied students, whether they played games, whether they did it in different ways. Make it a serious course and let them aim high and they'll be satisfied at the end.